recognize that in the community of faith, or living in the community of love, one of the characteristic hallmarks is to recognize that where two or three are gathered, God is in the midst of them, but also trouble is present. And how does that community respond when trouble or discord or disagreement emerges in the community of faith? Number one, Jesus suggested that we go one-on-one. First, to understand the nature of the disagreement. Secondly, if the party that you visit does not listen to you, take a small community. You remember I warned you, don't take gossips. Don't take people who cannot contain confidentiality. Then the third step, what Jesus suggested, he says take the church with you. And if the one does not listen to you, excommunicate them, break up relationship with them. If we follow the trend, today's gospel leads me to the second part of a theme of living in the community of love. The community of love seeks to settle discord, but secondly, the community of love is characterized by the gift of forgiveness. For where love is, forgiveness is present. And so I want to speak on the second aspect of living in love, living in a community of forgiveness and forgivenness. But before I proceed to define forgiveness, let me state that forgiveness is not in word, but in the activity of the heart. It is easy for you and I to say, I forgive you. Words are cheap. But forgiveness, like Jesus says in the final line of the gospel, whoever of you does not forgive your brother or sister from the heart, forgiveness takes place in the heart. In each of us, there is the conceit, the self-centeredness, egoism, and all the things that are negative to God's spirit that pervades our minds, that justifies our anger, and puts us on a pedestal on our own, which does not measure up with God. As forgiveness begins with a sense of humility, a sense of forgiveness starts with the heart. That heart is first of all motivated or energized with the gift of humility. The heart that is humbled will have a place where forgiveness is present with them. As I prepared and as I thought through, one of the verses of scripture that came to my mind was the words of Jesus on the cross. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. I do not believe that Jesus understood this to mean in the context of ignorance or arrogance. It's only that basically they did not know the full intention of their hearts. That through the crucifixion, through crucifying him, mankind's debt that could not be paid for would be paid for in full. Thus, I believe that the writer of the hymn, Jesus paid it all to him I owe, is an expression of our inability to pay, and God providing the way of salvation for you and I. God recognized that his creation was incapable of paying for their sins, so he forgave and continues to forgive his creation even to this day. It's easy to talk about something and let you don't understand the content of it. What is forgiveness? I'm so glad you asked. What is forgiveness? Forgiveness is an act of pardoning an offender. In the Bible, the Greek word that is used for forgiveness is translated to mean to let go. To let go. Let's say that together. To let go. When we forgive, we let go. And if we let go, we let God. Because forgiveness involves us and God. For where forgiveness is present, God is present. So we let go. As when a person not demand payment for a debt, we let go. He's not able to. We just rule it out. Or in the gospel message for today, in the unmerciful slave, Jesus equated forgiveness with canceling a debt. Part of our human weakness is how we hold on to little things. And little things become monsters. And little things become illnesses in our own lives. I don't know whether you understand the intricacies when these doctors talk about psychosomatic illnesses. Your health is determined by how you think and feel and anchor. A negative energy produces illnesses that are not present in your body. And allow me for this aside. Many of us are taking pills we don't need to take because the problem is not scientific, it's in the heart. There are burdens we have carried. The more we carry those burdens, the more they eat us up. They zap our energy out of us. But when we let go, amen, we have a capacity of God putting in us new energies that stimulates, that motivates, and encourages us to move on in life. Who is it that you need to forgive this morning? That's the first question. Because sometimes in our lives, we are holding pain in our hearts against people who are already dead and gone. Does it make sense, does it? But we feel a sense of gratifying our position in holding on to it. And instead of living a free life, we are living in a life of bondage because we refuse to let go. This morning, open your heart, examine it. Whether it's a relationship that turned sour, whether it's a relationship that you were hurt through, let go. Let go. Allow God to free you from such bondage. We forgive others when we let go of resentment and give up any claim to be compensated for the hurt or loss we have suffered. The Bible teaches that unselfish love is the basis of true forgiveness. Sins keep the record. The consequences of the sin might follow, but the penalty has been paid. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Yeah, so when we look at this whole aspect of our forgiveness and our forgiveness, we recognize that sometimes we hold people responsible for little things. But allow me to speak about three characteristics that empowers our forgiveness. What motivates us to forgive? In the gospel passage for this morning, there are three things I identify. Number one is pity. I would say pity because I pronounce my T. But for you to understand, it's like pity party. When I say pity party, you understand the first word. Not so, it means pity. Feeling sorry. Holding on. You know, and this aspect, if we shift it from ourselves to God's intention for each one of us, the story that Jesus tells is simply this. The one who owes the debt makes a plea because of his inability to pay back. And the Bible says, and the king looks upon him and has pity on him. Wherever we are enveloped, directed, guided by human frailty and human inability to measure up to our standard, let us realize that the only way we can get there is by being pitiful of their situation. Because God looked down. God saw that humanity could not bridge the gap for sin. God looked down in pity of his creation, and God came down to us and then forgave us of our sins by dying on the cross. Second, empathy. First is pity. Unless we empathize with those who have wronged us, we will never have a capacity to forgive them. God became one of us. Hallelujah. He knows our struggles. He knows our pain. He knows our anxiety. He knows our frustrations. He knows what we have done over and over because he lived among us. But yet without sin. The only way we can be able to forgive someone is when we change positions with them. When we recognize it could have been me doing this to that person. And recognize that yes, indeed, because of our frailty and our inability to do things, when we change places, we begin to understand the intricacies and it changes our mind. How many of you who are men wished you were women? I'm sure the more you think about it, the more you don't want to be. But possibly women want to be men, you know, because they feel that men have championed the world for too long and they could pay back. But when we take ourselves as men and our reaction and relationship with the opposite sex, when we recognize that they are made in God's image, they are fragile, easy to be broken even though they have the inner energy that supersedes man's physicality in terms of muscles. When we recognize that they have a capacity of reproduction, reproducing whatever we give to them, and we handle them with care, then I believe many of us men would want to be like women. And when we change positions, we can begin to understand. When we empathize with them, it is the true nature of God. So first, God looked down in pity. Second, God was empathetic to our situation. He was not sympathetic only. Sympathy is to feel sorry. Empathy is to take the place of the other person who is suffering. And thirdly, forgiveness is motivated by love. Wherever there is love, forgiveness is present. Whenever we feel the presence of God, forgiveness takes place. Because you know what? Forgiveness starts in the heart. Because that when God takes residence in our lives, when Jesus enters our lives, and we experience this eternal relationship of becoming God's children, like John puts it in John chapter 1 verse 12, he says, as many as received him, to them gave he power to become children of God, born not of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. When our birth in Jesus, when we receive Jesus, we become anew, we receive new birth, God pours out his love into our hearts, and forgiveness becomes evident. So what affects us in this journey? First, we must never confuse forgiveness as stupidity, because some people think that the more you forgive them, the more stupid you are. They have a problem, you don't have one. Secondly, we must never take forgiveness to mean that we condone sin. Sin is sin. But if you take the story in the gospel, the one who owes the debt pleads with God. Pleads with the one he owes the money. I can't pay. Have pity on me. Have mercy on me. The place or the fullness of God's experience is first experienced when the vilest offender who truly believes and confesses Jesus as Lord, a pardon they receive for the debt they cannot pay. So we recognize that God's forgiveness is available to all. Amen? It's one that God has provided. But many a times we anchor, like the man in the story, pay me all, give me all that you owe me. I must recognize, though, that forgiveness is affected by the gravity of the offense. A scratch and a scar have different periods of healing. Amen? And if I take the analogy of the scar and the scratch, we have big scars, or we have created big scars in God's heart. And you and I hold on to the triviality of life, the little things that only created a scratch.
But on the same hand, some of us have been deeply hurt by people we trusted, people we immersed our lives into. We had so much confidence, they betrayed us. And forgiveness is difficult. I'm not asking you that I'm going to wave a wand, or anyone is going to wave a wand and you're going to forgive someone. I'm going to encourage you that as long as you are open to God's Spirit and allow God to fill you from inside, forgiveness will flow outward. As long as you keep your attention focused on the grievance and the provision that God has made, we will be held bondage. But as long as we let go, we'll be free. Forgiveness does not mean forgetting. If we think of it in the sense of behaving like nothing happened. So the question is, how do I know I've forgiven somebody? Or how does somebody know I've forgiven them? It's a good question. Let me suggest how you know. Number one, your memory will remind you of the activity, but your emotion will stay stable. Do I make sense? The thought of it does not aggravate your feeling anymore to revenge or anger or bitterness. You think about it, but it becomes a stepping stone to living a more victorious and glorious life. And as you deal with those processes of healing, forgiveness will be taking place in your heart. So I don't know who you need to forgive this morning. I could go on and preach on forgiveness for the rest of this morning, but it might be a thesis. And I don't want to present a thesis this morning. We've looked at what forgiveness is, to let go. Simple. Let go. God, in Jesus Christ, looked down with pity upon us, became one of us, and provided an anchor for us to live. Because the Bible tells me, for God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, and whosoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world. God sent his Son so that the world through him might be saved. But the question is, if we hold grudges, what benefit is it? Because forgiveness is an instrument through which the world recognizes our life in Jesus. How can you say you love God whom you have not seen, and yet you do not live in harmony with those whom you have seen? This morning, think about this whole aspect of forgiveness. Think about the cross and how much it says about God forgiving us in his love. Whenever I look at the cross, I am reminded that there is room at the cross for me. Bill had committed an offense against his parents, for which he was incarcerated. And he has spent 5 years in prison. And the day of his release was coming up. And Bill wrote a letter to his parents who were still alive. The irony of it is that behind their house laid the train line that would take Bill to the station he was to disembark from the train. He wrote a letter to his parents. He said, "Promise me one thing. If you have forgiven me, and you want me to know that I am going to be received back into the family, you see, spread a white bedspread on the line next to the railway line, and I will know I have been forgiven. Bill was almost home. He had shared with his seatmate the problem and how he was locked up in jail. He told him about the letter he has written. He said, I told them to hang a bedspread on the line in our yard. He says, I am too frightened to look. The closer they went, he bowed his head, closed his eyes, and told his friend, keep looking on the left, keep looking on the left. Suddenly there was a display of white bedspreads on every inch of the line. The yard was littered with white handkerchiefs and white bedspreads. And his seatmate said to him, open your eyes, you have been forgiven. You have been forgiven. When I look at the cross, I see a display of God's love to say to me, you are forgiven. You are forgiven. You are forgiven. Amen.